بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Respected Chairman Dr. Rahman, distinguished guests, brothers and sisters of faith, I have stood before you about 1 year ago, and at that time I also had the distinct honor and pleasure to address a subject which those who have come before me and many of those who came were good friends of the Jamaat, who are well-wishers and who are the ones who truly give us the hope that peace is a possibility, even in our lifetime. I last year left and went to a place called Qadian, the headquarters of our community in India. And then shortly after, I had a chance during this year to travel some places, and one place I went was Norway. Now, if you know about Norway, this is the place where the actual Peace Prize has a foundation and a headquarters. Thus, out of curiosity, I wanted to see this place where a prize is given every year to a number of well-deserved individuals in different fields of endeavor. Now, I don't know what it is, but last year also they cut my mic off, and this year they're giving me all this feedback. So, as I said last year, if you don't want me to come back, just tell me. I'll get the message. But perhaps I should pause for a second and let the feedback go on. So anyway, as I'm in Norway, I go to see the foundation. I visit beautiful display of accomplishments. It made me curious about Alfred Nobel, the man who is the founder of this prize, so to speak. And I read about his story, and something struck me that perhaps some of you may know, perhaps many who do not know. The story says that, can you imagine if today you woke up and you read your death certificate, you read your death notice? Today you woke up in the morning and you're reading the LA Times or something, and there it is, your name is splattered in the obituary column. It says, you have died. And then it describes who you are. Think for a moment, what do you think would be written about you today if this was your notice? I'm not suggesting this should happen. I'm just saying, just think for a moment. Alfred Nobel actually read his death notice while he went to visit his brother in France, Paris. The notice said, "Merchant of death has passed away, a man who has done more to inflict mutilation and death upon the human family." And it shocked and startled and stunned him to think, are these the words I'm going to be remembered by, a merchant of death? Why? Because he had developed dynamite, blasting caps, nitroglycerin to use for all kinds of destructive purposes. So naturally, at that point in his life, he was being defined by his engineering skill and the weapons of destruction he was leaving behind. It made him stop and pause and think about his life and his worth, and he went back. And years later, to the surprise of many of his friends and his family, he left a will bequeathing all of his vast fortune, in today's day about $245 million, to give to the person every single year who does the most for the benefit of humankind. That was his seminal moment. That was the moment where he saw the need for peace over war, for promoting life over death. It is in this sense that we all gather here today to talk about an attribute of God Almighty, As-Salam, God the source of peace. And this is a source that sometimes we're not always aware of, but peace is really all around us, even right now. Peace means the balance, the harmony, the equilibrium of life. Without that, nothing exists. And so this is the source that gives peace to creation. and you just change it one slight degree, as we see now in the oceans of the world. One slight degree of temperature causes such a tremendous impact on all of life, our life as well, right here in California. Most of the water we think is in the oceans to rise up in the skies and drop back down in rain, but the folly of that is that no. Most of the water is contained in mountains and snow, and without that snow in the mountains, as you well know, you get dry land. And that leads to what? Trees, shrubs, vegetation dying, and becoming the fuel for potential tremendous fires. And that's something I know all of us here are well aware of. In this past year, as we look back and think about what has happened around the world, and this is the time we do it. End of the year, we do our recollections, remembrances of what happened. The world remembers California for all the fires that took place here. Unbelievable damage. It's the worst fire season ever recorded in the history of California. And again, I'm sure you all know this. 1.9 million acres of land were destroyed. 10,000 structures, $3.5 billion of damages, and over 100 lives were lost. And the most glaring example of that, with the whole world watched with horror to see the scenes of canopies of flame as people tried to flee from those towns in the campfire, especially that one town that New York Times in their headlines blared, "Paradise is gone." The town Paradise, 26,000 people, razed to the ground. Nothing left but rubble and ash. And no one could believe this happening in our era of 2018, and this was in your backyard. So the balance of nature somehow is the justice we must also look at, because every single degree, every single part and particle of it, it counts. It leads to that life, or it pushes us toward an ultimate death. In this sense, I turn our attention to the Holy Scriptures. What does God speak to us about justice? The rabbi who came before me, he mentioned the quote, "The world rests on three things," as he said, "justice, truth, and peace." And as he said, they are all one, for where there is justice, truth prevails and peace is established. Again, the Bible clearly talks about justice, as again was mentioned by a former speaker. In Zechariah chapter 7, verse 9, "This is what the Lord Almighty said, administer true justice, show mercy and compassion to one another." This is scripture. And now let me add the words of the Holy Quran, the scripture of the Muslims. "Verily, God enjoins justice and kindness and treating others as if they were close kin." A similar word echoed, as you have heard already, from the words of the Talmud and the Bible. And yet here the Quran is going to take it one step further and define, what do I mean by being kind and loving to someone else? These are the verses we heard in the beginning. "O you who believe, be steadfast in the cause of God, bearing witness in equity. And let not a people's enmity incite you to act otherwise than with justice. Be always just, that is nearer to righteousness. And fear Allah, surely Allah is aware of what you do." So here, it's not just being kind to the other, kind to the neighbor, kind to the stranger. It's being kind even to the one who hates you, who spitefully begins to abuse you, insult you, mock you, who inflicts harm upon you. Even still, even then, we're told to be just and don't let the injustice of someone make you unjust. Remain just, remain kind, remain compassionate. And this is the highest teaching, the highest calling of the spiritual law of God Almighty, which is always just. God is not just As-Salam, the one of peace. He is Al-Adl. He's the one of justice. And he says, those who come from me, they will act as I am, and that will be a being of justice. So we in this community, the Ahmadiyya community, we believe that this is the calling and the day for all of us, for we believe in that person who was sent to revive the true teachings of Islam. Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, was sent in this day and age, as we believe, as that messenger, that Messiah, that awaited one, that reformer who was going to revive the lost teachings of the faith, Islam, and to reform the behavior of the Muslim world and the world at large, especially in the area of justice. We believe that, and therefore we accepted him. And now I want to share with you what he himself taught about this principle. He says, and I quote, "The principle to which we adhere is that we have kindness at heart for the whole world. If anyone sees the house of a Hindu neighbor on fire and does not come forward to help extinguish the fire, most truly I declare that he does not belong to me. If any one of my followers, having seen someone attempting to murder a Christian, does not endeavor to save him, I most truly declare that he or she does not belong to us." All of this may seem surprising to one who believes that Muslims are against the Hindus, Muslims are against the Jews, against the Christians, but in fact, this is the message of Islam, and this was the practice of the Holy Prophet of Islam, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. If you look at his life, he was the one to embody and illustrate the teachings and commands of God's word, the Quran. We call that sunnah. And his life was nothing more than, as his wife said, an embodiment of the Quran's words. How did he act? In his lifetime, he exemplified the highest standards of kindness and compassion and justice to all. Not just to the higher order of life, but even to those that crawl beneath the feet, fly above our heads, or move along our sides, animals, birds, and insects. On one occasion, he was teaching his companion. He said, there was a holy man who was sitting under a tree, and while he was dozing off, an ant crawled up his leg and bit him. Out of love for that holy man, all of his companions came, and they found out where that anthill was and burned it down. God then spoke to the holy man and said to him, would it not have sufficed you to have killed one ant? You have destroyed a community of those creatures that worship me. Meaning they too had a right to life. They too have a purpose of life. They are following their instincts in life. They're not biting us because they just don't like us. Something we are smelling or eating and that's getting them up under their skin. This is the human order, not the insect order. And so he said to this man, think about it. That's not justice. You had the right only to inflict the harm on the one that inflicted harm upon you, if you would do that much. Even still should have been merciful. There are many occasions when the Prophet of Islam again showed compassion during the course of his lifetime. When he was in, you can say, control and power in the city of Medina, on one occasion, a funeral passed by while he was sitting down with his companions, and suddenly, out of respect, he stood up. Someone told him that, O Prophet of Islam, don't you know this man who died is Jewish? And the Prophet turned to them in surprise and said, was he not a human being? Was he not part of the human family? Doesn't he deserve to have respect and honor and dignity in life and in death that we should sit down and let his funeral procession go by and not even consider and care and have any compassion for the person, whether living or dead. Again, it's well noted and repeated often, perhaps you've heard. During one occasion, he invited a delegation of Christians to come and engage him in a dialogue and almost a debate about the nature of spirituality and religion. It's been ongoing ever since. It will probably always go on, our theological differences, but in a very civil manner. At the end of this dialogue and discussion, they're about to leave, and the Prophet of Islam noticed they were in a big hurry. So he inquired, why are you in such a hurry to leave right now? What is the issue? And they said, it is our time for worship and prayer. We must leave and reach our place to worship. And he said to them right there, something which many would feel is impossible for a Muslim in Saudi Arabia, Iran, or other places right now to say to a Christian, this is a house of God. Why are you going anywhere? You may worship in my mosque as you wish. This was the justice and the compassion and the consideration for the need of that group who were in front of his eyes. There was no swords being drawn to kill them all. They're all infidels. Bar the doors. We got them where we want them. It was, this is a group that wants to worship God Almighty. Please use my mosque. And there are so many incidents that you find in his lifetime that speak to the issue of how peace can be established if we establish peace in our hearts first and treat all with this compassion and justice. I'll leave you with one last narration. Again, it is often repeated. Perhaps you've heard it, but I think on this occasion, it's most suitable to the subject. Like all prophets before him, the Prophet of Islam was rejected when he first gave his message. The Meccans didn't believe in Islam. The Meccans opposed Islam. And there were many amongst his own neighbors who didn't leave a stone unturned in opposition. There was one old lady who would every night collect the garbage that she would have during the day, whether that is the, you know, the portions of the animals she would cook, the meat, the intestines and these things, the filthy rubbish on the ground, and collect some thorns, and she would throw it in the pathway when she would see the Prophet of Islam moving by. This would go on every single day, like clockwork. She could see him coming, take out the trash, throw it in the ground so he would have to step on it or step around it. It says one day, as he's walking on the same path, knowing what's coming, there was no trash. There was no filth. There was no thorns in his way. And he was surprised because this is out of the ordinary now. So he inquires that, where's that woman who always greets me so nicely? Who has this expression toward me that I've gotten used to, but I don't see nothing today. Where is she? Someone told him, oh, Muhammad, don't you know that she's sick? She's in her house and she couldn't come out today. So what does he do? He goes to the door and he knocks. And her voice, feeble as it was, inquires, who is it? And he says, it's Muhammad. And suddenly her heart is gripped with the fear that perhaps this man has now come in my moment of weakness, of vulnerability, to take some revenge on me. And she says, go back. But he says, no, I cannot go back. My faith teaches me to look after the poor, the weak, and the sick whenever they are in need. I have come here today to look after you if you will allow. She opened her door, and as I said earlier, she opened her heart and her mind and allowed him in. And at that moment, when her heart was most amenable to a truth of justice, she saw the truth of Muhammad, and eventually she became also a Muslim. This, I say, is the true path we are called toward. And in essence, this is the message of love for all, hatred for none. To love all, whether they love you or not, whether they know you or not, or you know them. To love all of humankind, whether they're of your country or of another country. He loved the Arab and the non-Arab. And the last thing he said before he left The final sermon was, no Arab is superior to a non-Arab, nor a non-Arab to an Arab. A black has no superiority to a white, nor a white to a black. All of us are equal in the sight of God. All of us are from God, the God of peace, the God of justice. And thus, this was the message of Islam. Recently, as was mentioned, we have inaugurated a number of mosques in the USA under the auspices of our spiritual leader, Mirza Masroor Ahmad, who is the fifth successor Khalifa of the Messiah. And during that inauguration, addressing the crowd, I'd like to share some of his words. He said, it is absolutely true that we, Ahmadi Muslims, are peace-loving and seek to build bridges of love and hope between different religions and different communities. However, this is not because we have deviated from Islam or modernized in any shape or form. Rather, it is because we follow Islam's authentic teachings. Hence, we Ahmadi Muslims are sincere in our claim that we do not hate anyone. Moreover, we hold genuine love for all people and are ever ready to extend a hand of friendship to others. Just to give one small example, last year when a local Jewish cemetery was attacked here in Philadelphia and their gravestones were desecrated, the local members of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community immediately went to offer their support to the Jewish community and to stand in solidarity with them after this despicable crime. We seek no reward or gratitude for such things, because we are merely following what our religion has taught us, which is to stand shoulder to shoulder with the people of other faiths and beliefs in their times of need or distress. We champion the right of all people to live their lives free from discrimination or prejudice. This is the true message of Islam. This is the message of peace that we hope will prevail in the world. Again, I share one other passage from an excerpt of our Al-Khalifa. He delivered this in Capitol Hill in 2012 about the whole concept of peace. He says, quote, the truth is that peace and justice are inseparable. Peace and justice can never be separated. You cannot have one without the other. Certainly, this principle is something that all wise and intelligent people understand. Nevertheless, we find in many parts of the world that disorder and a lack of peace are prevalent. Such disorder is visible both internally within countries and externally in terms of the relations between various nations. Such disorder and strife exist even though all governments claim to make policies that are based on justice. We just started our meeting with liberty and justice for all. 2018, why do we still have so much struggle and strife in our nation and at our borders, in the international sphere, and worse than that, in the hearts and minds of so many who still hate, despise, and wish to be free from certain segments of our nation. This is what he's talking about. All claim that the establishment of peace in there is their primary objective. Yet in general, there is little doubt that restlessness and anxiety is increasing in the world, and so disorder is spreading. This clearly proves that somewhere along the line, somewhere, the requirements of justice are not being fulfilled. Therefore, there is an urgent need to try and end inequality wherever and whenever it exists. This leads me to my conclusion. And I'd like to take us back to that fire that raged here in California, the whole world was riveted by it. The fire that many were able to escape, and it consumed some. Tragic loss of precious, innocent life. Young, old, men, women, all races, all religions, all walks of life. The fire did not discriminate. It didn't say, just take this one and leave that one. 26,000 in paradise. The majority have seen their homes, their town, everything destroyed in almost a twinkling of an eye. It is this that also the Quran speaks about in terms of justice. To be just toward one another and in the world, otherwise the world begins like that ocean to tip slightly 1 degree left or right, 1 degree higher or lower, one movement within or without, and creates the imbalance that begins to destroy the human order and cause suffering. It is here that in the terms of divine scripture, fire also refers not just to the fire of this world, or if you think about scripture, the fire of the next. It talks about symbolically the fire, which is also called war, division and discord. Today, we are celebrating around the world the 11th day of the 11th month and 11th hour. What happened on this milestone of history? It's called Armistice Day. It's a day when the world came together and said, the war to end all wars will never be repeated again. There will never be another fire that will consume 9 to 10 million of our young servicemen, destroy the cities, overthrow governments, rewrite the map of the world. That will never happen again. We created a League of Nations. And our own government couldn't ratify the proposal. And so the League of Nations failed and set us up for the next war, World War II, 75 million now. But we said, never again after this war. And yet today, at this celebration or remembrance of the 11th day, the 11th hour, the 11th month, in Paris, one of the world leaders had this to say: old demons are reawakening, ready to sow chaos and death. History sometimes threatens to repeat its tragic patterns and undermine the legacy of peace we thought we had sealed with the blood of our ancestors. This is what is being discussed around the world. Wherever you'll go, you'll hear those who are understanding where we stand today, 100 years later. We are repeating history, and we have failed to understand the lessons of it to avoid another bloodbath, another terrible war. And as to this, His Holiness, our fifth cleaver, has been giving a message wherever he's gone in the world. It is to this that we now say, we ask the question, how much blood has to flow? How many nations have to be destroyed? How many lives have to be in peril to die, to be pushed into refugee status? How many towns have to look like paradise around the world before the world says, enough, enough, enough? As the rabbi said, justice, justice, justice. Let's live in peace. Let's do to the other what I want done to me. This is where we stand today. And so if we are cognizant, aware of this, he said in the end, I believe that now, these are the words of Al-Khalifa, I believe that now, rather than focusing on the progress of the world, it is more important indeed, it is essential that we urgently increase our efforts to save the world from this destruction. We are focusing on saving the planet. Let's save the people who walk out upon it. Because the people who walk upon it, if they can't get the food to eat, the shelter to protect them from the elements, the clothes on their back, and there's so many. I'm not talking outside our nation. Millions and millions of youth, children in our own nation don't have the food unless they go to school. That's the first and only meal they get every single day, and this is the most developed nation on this planet. There are many who are still walking homeless in our streets. There are many who still, out of a lack of compassion and justice, don't have a way to make any means in their life meet. Forget about the means of having a grand holiday celebration, as many of us may have been enjoying and giving thanks for in Thanksgiving Day and now in this holiday season, this season of light, this season of remembering God Almighty. Let us therefore, in the end, think about that fire. I cannot forget the images. I can't forget those harrowing tales of people who talked about being in their cars, right and left, front and back, was nothing but flames. And it made me realize that if we are, again, cognizant, no one wants this to happen in the life of anyone they love. So we have to make some resolutions now. This is the time of year everyone resolves to lose the weight, to save the money, to do something in the business, all the things we're going to break in February. I know, I get it. But the resolutions that are in the heart and soul, what can we do? What can everyone in this room do? This is the grander picture. I know no one's here as a president or a premier or a prime minister. You can't change policy so easily. But what can we do? The Prophet of Islam taught his followers, again, as I said, you will not be a true believer. You'll not have any faith. You won't be a person of conscience, of ethics, unless you want for the other what you want for yourself. Talking about this, again, His Holiness said, do we have ambitions to be mired in poverty? Anyone going to resolve that, okay, next year I want to be poor. I want to be in that line when you got to go around the corner to get a bag of food. Because your $50 a month in food stamps isn't going to take you so far. So I'm standing in the corner, and I'm hiding in the shadows because I don't want my friends to see me. Anyone making that resolution? You want to go to bed hungry every night, every night. Anyone praying that one, thinking that one, resolving that one tonight? I'm going to resolve in 2019 to go to bed hungry every single night. You want your children to be plagued with ill health, or your spouse or your family? Is anyone asking for this? To let the ravages of ill health because of a lack of medical facility or basic hospital care destroy the health of a loved one? Or to be uneducated. You can imagine there are so many illiterate just because their small children have to work in fields or walk for miles with buckets on their head to carry water from a pond back to their homes. Anyone praying or hoping or resolving that this is my 2019 New Year resolution? Of course, no normal person would ever hope for any of these things. Therefore, as Muslims, and I would say as humankind, we must seek prosperity not only for ourselves but for others. And it begins right here in our hearts. The philosopher Lao Tzu once said, if there is to be peace in the world, there must be peace in the nations. If anyone thinks you can fight this out and win peace, you are sorely mistaken. Nobel Prize founder Alfred Nobel realized that in his lifetime. You can never win a battle through the sword or the gun. If there is no peace, if there's to be peace in nations, there must be peace in the cities. If there's to be peace in the cities, there must be peace between neighbors. Islam doesn't say love your neighbor means the person next door. The Prophet said everyone in your vicinity is your neighbor. And in your country is your neighbor. Even in your world is your neighbor. A Palestinian man once said, I wanted to invite my neighbors and friends into my home, but my home was much too small. So I began to push back all the four walls of my home. And before long, my home became the world, and all of the people became my friends and neighbors. This is the real meaning of justice that will last for all. When we push back all those barriers, break down all those walls, remove all those things, those locks in our minds, our hearts, our souls, and embrace the human family as one family and treat them all as I want to be treated, with love, with justice, with care and compassion, with consideration for all my needs. And then he says, there must be peace in the home. If there is to be peace in the home, there must be peace in the heart. This is the greatest few ounces of flesh in our body. And if it is pure and holy and full of love and justice, then nothing but peace and justice will emanate from it. That's, my friends, all of us, that's what we can do here tonight. Let us resolve, and I've written a few, and you can add to them as you wish, to maintain peace in our hearts. Let us resolve to have love for all. Let us resolve to treat all with kindness and justice. California had the largest Native population in the whole country. It still does. But 90% was decimated out of injustice. And the other 10% still are not being considered and given their right dues. This is the California story. Imagine the world. We are the most civilized nation. Let us resolve to want for everyone what we want for ourselves. Let us resolve to be the best neighbor and extend our neighborhood to the entire world. And let us resolve to extinguish the fire of hatred, the fires of hatred, and kindle the flames of love so that all countries and all conflicts will end, and our love will extend to all lives, all cities, all nations, and the entire world. May God make it so. Thank you so much for the time once again to be with you. It's always a pleasure, it's a blessing to be here. It is something which I hold very dear coming to California. I have said in the past that this word to me reminds me of the words of my Khalifa, to be just. California, maybe or maybe not, the word caliph is Khalifa. So is this the land of the Khalifa, the land of the caliph? I don't know. It will be. And the whole world will be like California if California is a land of justice, a land of peace. May God make it so. Thank you so much.